get cracking. Welcome back, everybody. Here's your coverage of the D2CL. I'm your host for the English livestream, Toby One, coming to you from my wonderful temporary studio over here in Sweden at the Good House. My temporary studio equaling Traskell's bedroom. We are going in for our game number one, EG versus MYM, where MYM are in a bit of a sticky position. As far as all the groups go, there is still a little bit of room for maneuvering for teams to qualify themselves in. As it stands right now in group B, MYM will not qualify unless they take it 2-0. If MYM are unable to take 2-0, then it would be Relax who take out Virtus Pro. They are currently tied for fourth position in the top four positions from the group stage, advance themselves into the playoffs. So at this point, MYM, it is a must-win scenario for all their games tonight, or they end up saying, we don't go into a three-way tie for Group B. Group A also has the potential for another three-way tie. For all those details, hit yourself over to d2cl.org or jonah.com's coverage page for your viewing pleasure. All right. We're going to get ourselves focused again. So EG, Radiant Side for game number one. Again, this Batrider is capable of slipping through the ban stages. At this point, is because they took out the SK as well as the Lycan. SK a favored hero by MYM. Especially when you see the Darkseer being picked up so early on, they're like, yeah, this works. It is one of the greatest combinations out there, which, or at least, I say greatest, one of the most favored combinations which is out there at the moment. But they won't get it this time around. Instead, they get the Wraith King as well as the Darkseer. Wraith King, a guy which we didn't even see in our previous two matches. He will be there, and EG, they're going to have a hard time. The problem with the Wraith King, he's basically this second time thing where you've got to kill once and then you got to kill him all over again, which means you're going to have to stay ability as well as the DPS to do such an endeavor, which means Batrider's Blinky and Lasso might kill him off the first time, but he's got to drag him so far out of position that the rest of EG are there to compound him and then pound him again before the rest of the MYM support can come in to help him out. That's basically what they have to do. Either that or they force a fight early on and they just try and burn out his mana, which means you look towards heroes like Nyx Assassin, or possibly, well, Invoker if he's available for the EMP, but any kind of Necrobook-style hero as well could do the job. But you've got to burn off all that mana from the Wraith King in the very early stages. In the later stages, it's a little bit harder to keep the Wraith King down unless you've got multiple different mana-burning abilities. They could always try and go in for something like a Lion, for example. It's another stun, it's another Hex, and you do have the upside when you do such a thing that you have the mana drain against the Wraith King. So if you can hold him there long enough, 5-second arrow for example would be enough, you could drain out a significant portion of his mana where all he could basically do is die and respawn, he's back up again. He could throw a Hellfire Blast and then be out. That would work. But I don't think, not many teams have been doing that up against the Wraith King. They find mana drainers, but that's all really. So, Mirana and Batrider, they're two heroes that will not be doing such a thing. They never bill for such a draft.
5 seconds remaining. Reserve time.
So, MYM now, third pickup. Do they try and go for aggro try? Just throw the balls to the wall and see if they can get themselves through. Because if they're going to do that, they need a follow-up to the Wraith King. And they need some good aggro offensive pressure. Which is why you see PPD's bans. They took out both the Rubick as well as the Shadow Demon. The two major focuses were two major heroes which would work beautifully in an aggro tri lane. Instead, they go for a Skywrath Mage. Still works. It's good range harassment. It's nice nukage. It's good ceiling control as well. The downside is I'm not feeling it working up against the Batrider as well as the Mirana. Both heroes look to the BKBs. But more importantly, Batrider has the 4-star early on. So he'll get people out to safety. Yeah. Ozai. Is it finally going to happen? This is when we're going to run the Dread Ranger lineup. It's a silence. It's control. But more importantly, it's bonus damage to every single hero on the field for Evil Geniuses, including the familiars. Now, I asked for this to actually happen with a Lycan combo before. I probably won't. Their other option is they just say screw it and they build into something like an SF. And with the SF, they have more than enough DPS to basically pop anybody on the MYM lineup. They can just do some quick stacking, and then they just get themselves something like, I suppose you can get yourself like a follow. Okay, they really probably want the Bane now with the Weaver. Actually, no, even with the Silence, it's okay. They get themselves a Tinker. All right. It's a lot of global control. Tinker as well as Visage also work nicely because you can BT into the familiars, so you can really set up for some nice fun ganks. Crit's going to take out the last hero, feeling it's going to be a Bloodseeker. In this game, though, the role of the three three cores has probably been filled. They could push Mirana to the support role, but the chances of that, I would say, will be negligible.
10 seconds remaining. 5 seconds.
But the choices
remaining.
Are still pretty open, and PPT, he looks over to Edwards MYM and goes, okay. The only hard decision they've got right now is who is in the middle lane. The answer is probably going to be the fifth pick from MYM. Because you got Wraith King as well as Sky Wrath Mage already there. Storm Spirit will probably be high up on the list as far as ban heroes. It doesn't synergize perfectly with the lineup, but it's mainly because there's not a huge amount of lockdown control coming out from EG at the moment for such a hero. And he would cause a lot of problems for the tanker. Because normally it's that or it's the Clockwork, but they actually say it's going to be a Tidehunter. So they're feeling that the mid solo is going to be something different from MYM. Does this also mean we run a safe lane Tinker with the Mirana in mid?
Storm Spirit.
No, it's Storm Spirit.
Radiant team.
It most definitely is Storm Spirit. If you look at it from MYN's perspective, and they want someone to kill, and the best way to find it is not to have a Blink Dagger over on Wraith King in this lineup, because that actually won't work. The maneuverability from EG is way too high. You need someone that can keep jumping and keep following. That's why Storm Spirit instantly propped up into my mind as the best option here for MYM. But if EG, like, they could try and get themselves a global silence here. In fact, the global silencer. That could be a potential third hero pickup. And then they run Visage, Mirana, Silencer. They could split it around. They should go with Earthshaker instead. The only melee hero they're going to pick up in this entire draft. And not the hero I thought they were going to go for. It's some nice control over the lanes. And I'm wondering if EG have some more developed lane control coming out from the future. Obviously, it's one of these things that got nerfed to absolute hell. So it doesn't really properly control up the lane at all. But at the same time, just trying to work out what they're trying to achieve with it, because they don't have, like, it almost feels like insurance. That's all it really feels like right now, to have that Earthshaker, where you could have someone which can be on the front lines of controlling or moving back inside the jungle. This Earthshaker, it kind of feels like it's a roaming Earthshaker. Very similar to what we've seen No-Tail been doing recently with his Earthshaker. Just trying to move yourself into a nice position where you turn the tide of all your cores in the lanes. We'll see how successful that's going to be. So we get Universe on this Batrider again for our second time tonight. He'll be heading up towards the north. TZ will be the Tinker in towards the middle lane, which puts PPD support Earthshaker, Zai onto the Visage, and leaves Mason as the Mirana for MYM. While MYM, they're running Ace on this offlane Darkseer. Think about how it works with a Darkseer. Surge away, Rock Wall comes down, Surge is then wasted, then Grave Chill, slow enough for the arrow to connect, and kills then start coming in. Ryze is taking the Weaver towards the middle lane, probably the only way they can feel they can run him as a core here, as they're not feeling the fact that Link would get any kind of farm. Observer Ward's already going to spot the fact out that they're coming up here towards the top lane. So Storm Spirit, as well as the Sky Wrath Mage, there's a lot of control they can get in close, and then the support Wraith King comes into play too.
30 seconds to battle.
Look to see how much he's capable of pulling out of the jungle. I'm interested to see just how successful he will be in this game. Because right now, like, global-wise, both MYM's got good counter global ganking, and EG's got good global pushing. And EG has good initiation coming out from the Batrider, while MYM have a good counter initiation if it's going to be the Wraith King, for example, dying down. You've got Surge Aways from Darkseers, you've got Sky Wrath Mage with slows, nuke damages out, you got timelets from Weaver, so they got a lot of ways to evade. It really feels like EG are going to be the ones setting the tones of the fight. But it's going to be MYM that will be deciding if they're in a bad enough position that EG is capable of getting killed or if they get counter killed. So it's really going to come down to MYM being on the ball for this game. If they're not, may as well call that GG. TZ. Well, Ryze is going to have a real rough time here. I think he knows he's got to farm with Shikuchi. Yeah, he attacks once, farms with Shikuchi. He wasn't really intending on that one hit to connect properly. Oh, I wish I could be a twat. More illusions just being annoying. Wow, Universe also having himself a good time up against crits harassment. Maybe not that great a time. It's 70 mana to throw that nuke out, and already Universe is forced back so far. He can't use his mana against Link, which is good because it means that Link can find himself some last hits in. Not getting the perfect waves in, but he's still doing a pretty damn bang up job. And Ryze. Oh, he's gonna watch this one closely. Shikuchi again trying to find the last hits in there, looking for denies or last hits. He goes 4-2 up against 5-3. But he's gonna burn through a lot of his mana to do so. He's only got one Shikuchi left. Now Ace is on the run. Fissure is available. He surges away, but they push Ace out of their own jungle, which was the primary objective here by EG. And looks like Batrai's just given up on that top lane. He knows he's getting zoned out, so he needs some stacks. He needs some time, though, to stack this up. And again, we have another one of these things. I can't remember who I was talking to last night about this. We just talked about EG's lineup. And it's just the same thing, time and time again. There's no real massive changes to the way they play it. You have Arteezy with a flash farming game-changing hero. You have Universe with a surviving hero on the top lane or a easy fallback to a different kind of thing, like a Batrider jungle kind of thing, like hero. Doesn't have to be much, but there's like 3-4 options they can mix between, so it's fine. And then you put Mason on a very comfortable initiating hero with supports to make sure that all the lanes work for him. And that's exactly what Visage as well as Ursa can do. Especially when Visage gets up to that level 6 and you add familiars in towards the mix. It's going to be very, very difficult for MYM to really keep control of these lanes later on. But they're going to try and give it a crack at Arteezy. The March of the Machines has already gone down as Ryze doesn't want to stick inside this. Now Arteezy does the right job. Moves up towards the front lines and tries to do as much damage as possible. Now Ace, he's trying to steal the stack. Now Fissure, not down in time. The Observer was definitely watching all of this, and Ace is really sticking around a little bit too long. A little Grave Chill, Zai trying to mop up a little bit of points up for the Soul Assumption. The Fissure trying to also steal these lasers with a double Iron Shell. They're basically taking each other. But the Fissure actually holds them out far enough that they can farm up the last hits and separate them because they got split with the tree line. Without breaking too much of the tree line. Small little thing, but nice. But Darkseer still found himself some experience as well as now 6 last hits, so it's not bad. 3.5 levels for Ace on this offlane. Link's still doing a decent job too. 17, now about to become 18 for 8. If he can get himself a last hit here. There we go. So we should have a Storm Spirit with some decent money early on. Again, same thing to be said about Arteezy. There's been no gank on the Tinker. And because of this, like, he's just getting free farm at this point. He's got Boots and a Null Talisman. Normally, you still want to get Sol Ring and Bottle before you go into your BTs. Because you just get shut down. Oh, Ryze! Whoa, Ryze! The Bottle Charges were fast enough. And Arteezy's just shot a man to finish the job. Crit will come in with both Concussive Shot as well as Orb, but Arteezy's physical DPS is enough to battle up against Crit. At the same time, Crit's got more Noose coming in, but with the Firefly, Sticky Napalm, EG's trying to capitalize on the situation, and Ryze got fidget up! Comes down, Shikuchi up, Sentry Wall can see him, but they can't get the kill down on him. They move up for the Skywrath Mage instead. The Weaver would have been an even bigger kill to take there. But still, EG with the first blood. Ends up going the way of Arteezy, so they insert more money into this Tinker. He can buy BTs and just over 1,000 gold if he wants to. But as I said, Sol Ring and Bottle is going to be the way you normally do run for the Tinker. Which you just have no mana to work with if you don't. Mason's at least found himself a little bit more space on this bottom lane. 24 for 3 now, finally managed to catch up to that Storm Spirit. Speaking of which, Link not ganked before his level 6 as well. So the two heroes, this is probably also the reason why Storm Spirit ended up in the top. They wanted to make sure that gank never came. The battle happened in mid, and Ryze thought he was the one that could be escaping from it. Skywrath Mage, though, ended up going into this man fight with Arteezy, which was always doomed to end because Batrider would just come in the way he did. Earthshaker doing the same thing, and then you got this range jump in problems that are just created so easily. With minimal effort. Ace. Is there going to be a Fissure for this one? There's a Surge Fissure. Going to waste a lot of the time. Firefly had to be used to catch up to it, but there's no way that this Batrider wants to do that. Not to mention, he was still wanting to stick back and stack. So now they actually do get their stack up, which means the Burst Mage is going to be there for the Batrider. With these waves as well, still set of Mud Golems. Well, there's no point flying up or flying back into the wave either. Universe. But he will still take the money. Still push him up to about 1400 gold. Actually only 1300. Not worth as much as I thought. So still a very long way to go for the Batrider before he can really be that jump in initiated that they're searching for. That lasso controller on Link. Tinker's copying a little bit of damage, but looks like it's just because he's stacking and farming. They just want these BTs up and running. 4 points march to the machines. It's all about the map control. No risk Dota for EG here. Again, just moving through the motions. No reason to risk anything else. Rana's still having himself all the space in the world. Because Ace has just abandoned. Did the same thing as the Batrider. Said, I'm not going to get anything off this offlane. I'm not achieving anything trying to leech in the experience from inside their own jungle pull points. So the only other major choice is just to abandon the lane. But while you do that, it should add some exposure to the lane. Now, Mirana can't capitalize on that, but when you come in with the Wraith King with 1 point Vampiric Aura, it's not a lot, but it may just be enough that you could force out some extra damage to that tier 1 town to open up for a later push. With the catapult coming in too, someone from EG has to come up here. There's already movement coming from PPD, but they'll require a TP support in if they want to protect this tower as well. But then again, PPD says no. He's got Ancients to sack. They just let the T1 tower go. He couldn't get there in time, and that must just mean no one else wanted a TP in there to help it. They want to make sure Arteezy gets BTs and Sol Ring. He has the bottle. So that's the combination. That's all they're really searching for here. EG's got their mindset on the prize. They know what they want and when they want it. And when they want it, it's not pre-10 minutes. I actually have it basically on the 10-minute mark. Actually, no, they will actually have it pre-10 minutes with the BTs. Does that mean Visage? No, he doesn't have his yet. So they have their full combo, but still. A BTing Tinker is nothing to be sneezed at. Observer Ward's down, so they see the stack. It's just Crit having a bit of a wander around. Two nice aggressive Observer Ward's too. I mean, this top lane position of MYM can be just that little bit more aggressive in positioning. Dire's bottom tower, so he doesn't have to back up every time to get farm. He has some early warning systems. Not to mention having Crit just hanging in the trees. There's going to be some extra moral support. Give him some pom-poms and you've basically got the effect I'm talking about. This Wraith King's not level 6 just yet. Mason's already up with level 7. But you see where they want to focus this bottom lane. Soul Assumption plus Star Storm. They're the things which are getting maxed out down here. They want burst damage. They want instant kill and move on to the next. If it could be a support, wonderful. If it's a Wraith King, they'll take the kill and then just leap back away, all that kind of jazz. And they can use Familiars as cover fire if Wraith King is even attempting to try and chase it down any further. So we just got Blink Dagger up and running. That's going to be over on our Batrider. So 9 minutes 30 Blink Dagger and 9 minutes 30 BTs. MYM not in the most comfortable positions. 500 gold, 2000 experience. It may not seem like much of a 10 minute sim, but considering the control which EG are about to force towards MYM, like backing them into their own tier 1 towers, it's a major problem. Especially when Batrider does something like this. Blink, Lasso, the Wraith King, he's just shot a level 6. Flamebrae's gonna push him back, he's gonna die to Mason's arrow. So they actually give the extra gold over towards the Mirana too. Goes towards the Build Mason the Drums Fund, and then into the tier 1 tower in the bottom lane. Tinker if he wants to could come and join the party, but for now, he wants to make sure this top lane pushes out a little bit further. They gotta make sure Link doesn't get to this Orchid. Once his Orchid is up, then he can cause issues for the Tinker. And the only thing which is gonna stop such a thing is having a ganking combination. Now Ryze, the Fissure, he time-lapses. There is a small gap in that Fissure line, allowing him to just run away. He's just trying to time it right. With the Sentry Ward that's also down for EG, that timing's a little bit more difficult. It's gonna be okay. Storm Spirit, nah, it's just Observer Wards. I thought for a moment with that Courier flying north, maybe you managed just to flash farm something. But not to be the case, EG still 2-0 in front.
Radiant's top tower is under attack.
The Mason's up to 1600 gold.
Middle tower
is he going for a late Midas here? Is he either he's going to buy Drum straight or if he feels he can buy a BKB straight? Could be his other option here. The physical DPS of the Weaver won't really come online till later. So in the meantime, you've got the problems of Skywrath Mage, the Storm Spirit Orchid, a Darkseer, and then you're like Wraith King with Hellfire Blast. So they are problems. Blink, Lasso, in comes Tinker. Skywrath Mage just failed, Link is dead. And now actually he may be dead. Universe moving very, very quickly. And another TP, are they trying to use the Familiars to get in closer for Arteezy? Rearms, that's gonna be Sol Ring to BT out. Back out again. And the March Machine's forced Ace behind the tower. So they kick up, they kill off the Storm Spirit before the Orchid's up and running.
Bottom tower has fallen.
Yeah. What I was thinking is it's gonna be a full BKB. What's on the courier? It's still gonna be the standard Mason build. He's going in for the drums.
Radiant's middle tower.
That's the primary goal of him. Universe finds a nice little stack on the side.
Invisibility.
Easy farm, easy levels, easy gold, easy money. They're having a great old time while Ryze up on the high ground in the mid. With this hand of Midas, he really makes him susceptible to death. If this arrow from Orana does connect correctly, there's a runaway. Arrow, while he's Shikuchiing too, rockers to fly. They will disjoint though, because he went invis up the hill. But it was when he was out of range of the sentry ward, which made the difference, so it disjointed the rockets. And now Mason found another one. Familiars come in to start with. Point blank range arrow. Well, doesn't hit, but the Starfall plus the familiar drop downs will be enough, and he's gonna leap himself away. Concussive shots already connected over here, while Storm Spirit actually killed off the Tinker a little bit further down the lane. Moonlight Shadow tries to protect him, but there's a sentry wall which is in range of. Now he tries to walk out of range of a Fissure on four. He got the orb's gonna fly up there. Mason's dead. He can't evade that one. There's no way to do it. While Batrider jumps in, he's able to get the kill over from the Skywrath Mage. Ace running away from these familiars. Again, trying to find a lot of damage. And Zai has to back up. He's got Soul Assumption damage and can turn onto Ryze here if PPD had enough mana for a Fissure, which he was just short of with a stick on cooldown for an extra 2 seconds. Link was able to find himself a big kill. Fissure missing. Alright, a long way. And Ryze, oh man, you gotta be really careful with that. Luckily for him, those familiars didn't have a lot of damage. And that Fissure again. PPD is meant to be the huge controller during that fight. The Fissure, a little bit more lax as far as the control. MYM was still able to freely move around. And MYM definitely coming out on top after that fight. Question is, can they keep that pressure up? Again, Arteezy just to the offlane with a Blink Dagger now available. It's very difficult to catch out Arteezy. And if he goes into a Lincoln Sphere, it's going to get even harder.
Top tower is under attack.
He might actually consider a BKB of his own. But normally you don't want to go into a BKB over on a Tinker when you're going up against someone like a Storm Spirit, because he'll just keep up with you. Right? You want to TP yourself out, he'll just chase you down, find you, interrupt you. You want to trigger a BKB every time you want to TP yourself out of here. Now Mason, he's in trouble. Fissure splits crit up here. Starfall, almost enough to kill off crit, but Ace came in with that mech charge just in time. Echo Slam from PBD buys the spade. There's the Mirana finally going down. So the kill from the Storm Spirit. At the same time, Skywrath Mage should take a fall. PPD stunned up the Firefly and Lasso. Gonna go on Link. They're controlling finally the Storm Spirit. So he stops causing him problems. Raid King, there's no ulti available for him at the moment. And there's TP coming in from the Tinker. Smack bang into the middle of the fight with all the mana he could ask for. There's going to be a rearm from Arteezy. But as the time lapse out from Ryze, Familiar's hot in his tail. They will see him move down. Not enough damage on them, but they're just trying to keep the vision going. Following his path up through the mid, Universe still right behind him. Keeps the sticky napalm. Familiar drop down, rockets to connect. EG chases successful to kill down that Weaver. So three cores and one support loss for MYM during that fight. Should I say core? I'm used to seeing everything as a core now in my own mind. Two supports and two cores, sorry, going down for MYM during that last engagement. Storm Spirit was still able to afford up his Orchid before death. So that's the upside for Link. And now they're going to smoke and move down south. Probably hoping to catch Arteezy when he's down here at some point. But Arteezy with the double march, the Machines Wave, he's going to push this bottom lane out a very long way and then just switch to top. And this is the downside. You basically got to prepare your trap for Arteezy and then wait for him. And if you don't find Arteezy in the right position, it's not going to work. And this is the right position. They feel they can find him. He's going to do a second wave March of Machines. Orchid's there. Vortex back with the Hellfire Blast. They come underneath the March of Machines, but they get the kill so quickly. Especially with that Iron Shell. Is it level 4? Level 4 over on Link. So they rip through. They rip through the life points there of Arteezy. And this is why Storm Spirit was such a great pickup as the last one. And MYM can now force the issue on bottom lane. Got some good creep clearing with both Iron Shell as well as that Static Remnant from Link. Radiant's bottom tower is under attack. Doesn't take much pressure while in middle lane. Weaver again getting picked off. Radiant structures are even fortified. Fresh Familiar is still up the sleeves here for Zai. Bottom T1 tower Radiant's will take a fall. Amaze is now up on the top lane farming up. So going for this is his full-on standard build. So Phase Boots, Ring of Aquila, Drums, and then into Maelstrom. Straight into Mjolnir, and then for the BKB. Depending on what the situation calls for. In this game, BKB. Because he's not like the Tinker, which has to keep the safety of his TP. He might also be looking at a Scythe device here, Arteezy, but I'm pretty sure it's going to be a Lynx.
Radiant's bottom tower is under attack. Dire's top tower is under attack.
Well, Tier 1 tower now is going to be attacked by Mason. TP is on the way here, but there's a lot of support still hovering around. So Arteezy feels a lot safer with PPD and Universe watching his back. What's Universe also got as a recipe? Mask of Madness. They give him one more camp, and he basically has it. All the top tower would do. But they're hoping someone comes to defend it. Martian Machines always make it, so EG's tower traits are worth it a lot more for them because they know they can hold their front positions. So Miranda does take the tower. The Mask of Madness is up with the Blink Lasso. So it's high movement speed with the four staff as well for the Batrider. This is 18 minutes in on a Batrider. Universe is so farmed up. The Static Remnant will see him. That's the vision from it. So they decide not to come in. And instead Link moves down to the bottom lane with his Haste Rune to farm it up. Interested to see if Link's looking for a Bloodstone or if he's looking for a Lincoln Sphere himself. Worried about these initial stuns out in him. Which can just control and hold him there. Might also be worried that is going to be a Scythe of Ice up for the Tinker. With the way they keep injecting money into Arteezy, I wouldn't be surprised if he does just jump straight for it. It's asking the question right now, does EG want to play safe? Do they hold back and just accept the fact that, like, you know, Lincoln Sphere can protect them, they should be able to win on a split push in the late game. But then again, would they? Piranha still needs a huge amount of DPS in order to combat both a Weaver as well as a Storm Spirit. But at the same time, Storm Spirit, like, he's the only one with the farm out of the two. The Weaver's sitting lower than the Batrider right now. Batrider is better at this point of the game because his hunting is just so strong. He's got so many different ways of breaking through any kind of linkers, but Weaver's not even doing that. He's got Hand of Myers and Treads, so Ryze doesn't have enough as this mid-solo. If the TP out by Tinker, Storm Spirit's too late at the jump. Tried to, but too late. And Zai's almost got himself his Aghanim Scepter. It really feels like MYM are just being poked and prodded around the map, but never actually having an incision made by EG. They're waiting their time out perfectly until their items are up and running. And Mason? Oh, he surprises me. He's switching over towards Amanda style. Maybe he thought that it wasn't as important to have that immunity throughout the team fight as such, but instead just make sure he can break free of the Orchid effect of the Storm Spirit. Which both I can understand. Storm, long jump down again. Not quite sure exactly who he was going for. Didn't have a regeneration rune either. So Link's now having to walk all the way back to base with that mana he just burnt. Which means now MYM are not ready to fight in mid. And MYM EG quite clearly saw that. Rises up on the top lane now with 2.6k gold. This kind of feels like it is going to be a straight BKB from him. And it is actually a side device from Tinker. So we got continuous Hex to come from Arteezy. And now a gank from Universe. Going to find Ryze a little bit further up if he makes the move. And now, most definitely sees him. They need some detection. Sentry ward. He's too far away. Four stuff up with the Fissure means Ryze is held in position. No ability to time-lapse out because he is lassoed up. And the Rocket's coming in from Arteezy trying to help him out at the last moment. But the Weaver goes down again. The mid-solo for MYM. Having some real trouble finding his feet. Zai, stop for a moment, micro, either that or he's on a bit of a nap, and then summons up his new Aghanim's Familiars, and look at the damage to crit! Oh man, these guys hurt! Familiar drop one, Familiar drop two, extra damage, Familiar not even going to drop the third, he's waiting for the Ankh to come up, and then drops the third. This is that say ability during the fight, the Vac will come in from Aso, making three copies, and now Wraithing, he turns onto Zai, four stops him away though. They cannot keep up with the kills, they cannot keep up with the positioning to try and get these kills. Now Link, he's at least able to, but Fissure, Familiars, they don't have the drops. The TP's coming from the Tinker, he's going to be right on the back here of Link with the Hex as well, and the Familiars with the damage is only minimal at this point, but they keep the secondary Hex going. EG are making an absolute beautiful play, time and time again. Ryze even gets arrowed on the top lane, welcome to the lane, Ryze. 2.4k gold now on this Weaver. He might have been thinking maybe he got enough money for drums and everything else, or just buy a straight BKB and then surprise, but nope. Nathan's also going to switch his mind again too. He's just gone for the casual Yasha, and now goes into the Maelstrom. I think he just realized anything they can have to fight earlier on is better, and those Familiars! 23 minutes in Aghanim's Familiars, and they're up at level 2. No one wants to fight up against that. These Familiars solo support heroes. And we just keep having it too, where Arteezy is able to BT himself in time and time again on the back of him, continue to farm, move in for the ganks, always in the right position and always able to fight. And they're coming back into middle lane. Arteezy TP front lines, looks towards Ace, and it's actually Universe. He arrives out of absolutely nowhere. Arteezy was there, he just blinked very, very quickly. And all of a sudden, Darkseer finds himself dead and the tier 2 tower is also gone. And now Dagon level 1 is built on Arteezy, so the burst damage is now getting even higher. He keeps himself secret, blinking to the other side of the tree line, so there is no way for MYM to know about this Dagon just yet, unless they've got the clickers fingers in the west and eyes. Double damage. EG's prepping for the tier 2 tower in the bottom lane. They've taken mid, the top tower's being played around with Arteezy. Now the Dagon is shelled out. Basic right clicks bring down the Skywrath Mage. He's a level 8 Skywrath with Urn, Wand, and a pair of brown boots. It's not enough to fight up against this Nukic combo. And then you look towards middle lane, again we go Rockets. Link and Wraith King down half of their life points, and he goes in again. Link turned into a piglet. And he forces the Wraith King to keep his eyes turned towards him, which means the space is made for bottom lane EG. And Familiars just keep pushing. They drop down again. What do we actually got? Arteezy, you're in over your head, man. Way too far over your head. He buys the Dagon recipe level 2 before death, but now Batrider, he jumps in, lassoing back the Wraith King with the Flame Break burst damage. Fissure going over towards Link. He's got one more jump and goes over the rock wall, but he goes up high. The arrow from Mason has a fish, but Link, he's going to stick around here. He's got one more jump, and that's basically it. Out of mana now, and Universe, sticky napalm, Flame Break can push it back down again, and that means they get themselves the kill. 18 for 8. MYM haven't lost racks just yet. But I'm pretty sure they're at the point right now of saying, okay, when EG does this, this is EG trying to save some time. They're coming in, they're finding kills inside the base, under the tier 3 tower on the top lane, while the tier 2 tower is still up there. And MYM will be very much considering, there it is, right there. It's the mental advantage which EG is able to get when they do such a maneuver. If they didn't do that, MYM probably could have been sitting there going, ah, maybe, guys, maybe we can still find some space. It feels like it's over, but is it really over? When EG do a maneuver like that, it's over. Completely over. And we're going to finish at game number one like that. Game number two will be up shortly, so stay tuned, peoples. It is our final game of the D2CL for the night, coming to you live from Sweden, from the Good House.
Let's get cracking!